Hi, thank you for tuning in to BPTV. I'm your host, Andy Amrine, and this is Around Town with Andy Amrine. And today's show, we are going to be talking to the one and only Johno Prasek, a world-renowned artist living, growing up here in Pittsburgh. And I can't wait to share with you the story and all his artwork. So thank you for tuning in and hope you enjoy the show. Johno, love the studio. Thank you for the invite to come in. And why don't we start at the beginning for you? I mean, I know you've had a storied life in Pittsburgh. You're born and raised here. So how about walking us through the life and times of Mr. Johno Prasek?
Wonderful. Welcome, Andy, Dave, Bethel Park TV, to my studio, Johno's Art Studio in the Southside Slopes. I was born in 1959. In Munhall. The first 3 years of my life were there, and then my folks moved to Dormont. Mm-hmm. I have five siblings and two parents, so my home would be Dormont.
Okay.
Growing up, I'm a Dormont guy. A regular guy growing up in the 60s and early 70s. We had a lawn business, two paper routes. My parents encouraged us to keep our grades up. Then we could do that, we could play sports. I love playing baseball. I had visions of younger, in my youth, to be I love Roberto Clemente. I saw him play twice, one of my baseball heroes, and also wanted to be an astronaut.
Oh, okay.
Space program, Apollo 11, all that. And we just had a good upbringing in Dormont. My dad was from the Depression, one of my heroes, and my mom, too, was from that era. And they helped me in my journey, and they encouraged us to obviously do well in school and to find your passions. They exposed us to a lot of different things.
Okay.
My dad also said, see the junk, when people put their junk out on the street, that's when you can take it. So if you see that three-legged chair, let's bring it home. Let's see if we can fix it or repurpose it. Or we had a potbelly stove, we burned it. The idea was keep it out of the landfill. So that was all instilled in us, and that's part of my beginnings of an artist.
Where did you go to school?
Grade school, St. Bernard's, Mount Lebanon.
Okay.
Then Keystone Oaks High School, graduate in 1977.
All right.
Everything was good all along. I'm the oldest of six kids until age 13. It seemed suddenly back then I got deathly sick with ulcerative colitis. They didn't know what it was at first, and I was misdiagnosed because it was kind of a different disease. It's a disease of the intestines. I found out I had a case on a scale of 1 to 10, I had 11. It was hell, pure hell, through 10 years of hospital visits inside and out. I wasn't able to graduate at the time. Luckily, in Keystone Oaks, I had enough credits, but I didn't have to go back my senior year because I had enough credits. So luckily, I was able to graduate. I hit bottom, but I had a loving family and friends, so I just kept, you know what, I can get through this. I'm a young guy. Mm-hmm. You work through these problems. Then I can remember how... it was the winter of 77. It was a horrible winter here. It was very icy. I was on a cane because one of the side effects of colitis is taking azulfadine and prednisone is arthritis. I could hardly walk. And I was thinking about taking my own life. And I walked on to the Duquesne Bridge and I thought about it. This is the way to, if I'm going to do it, this is the way to end it. Then I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it to my parents. I couldn't do it to me. So maybe I needed to do that. Okay, come back, graduated high school. I'm in remission. Okay, I didn't have any money or anything. I wasn't able to go to college at the time. I had aspirations to go to college or learn a trade, but I still was kind of beat down physically that I wanted to join the Navy. I thought, I'll get in the Navy, serve our country for 4 years, and you know they wouldn't take me because you have colitis. So, okay. So I got sick again around early 20s, deathly sick. So I had an operation that saved my life. It's called a total proctalectomy, permanent ileostomy, that instantly cured the colitis. But this bag saved my life, and it was a blessing in disguise. So I felt reborn, a second chance, age 23. So hey, awesome, life is good.
Mm-hmm.
During those convalescing times, I was down to 120 pounds at that time. I'm usually 190 to 200 in my adult life. So I like to do things. So I got library books from Dormont Library and Carnegie Library of Van Gogh's and Picasso's. And I didn't have a wife or a house or any time, and I had Rust-Oleum paints in my parents' garage. So I started copying Van Gogh's and Picasso's, which I'd love them artists read about their times, and I was able to copy them. I thought, you know what? If I was going to be a musician, I would probably copy the Stones or the Beatles, but I'm doing this, and I like this. So I met people in life, quit copying. I was just doing it, and start painting from your emotions, your dreams, the people you meet, your times, all that. So I stopped copying. I got the at the time I got the best bartending job in Pittsburgh, Mario's Southside Saloon, 1986. I worked there for 20 years behind the bar till 06. Bob Pestilano gave me a chance. He was the owner at the time. I went to work. I love working there. I met so many good people, and I always say thank God they drank, and but they were behaved. And we had a really good crowd. We had families coming, and I treated the place it was going to be my like it was my bar. And Bob knew that. So he knew I painted, so he let me hang my paintings behind the bar. And that gave me confidence.
Nice.
You know what, maybe I can do something with this. I never stopped painting. I always did that. And then I hung a couple up, and a little notoriety made me feel good and just worked through it. Then I met this lovely lady, Maria DeSimone, who was an artist. Let's go back real quick. Early summer 1988, this gentleman walks in the bar with a bird on his shoulder. He was a welder from Jessup Steel, volunteer at the old Pittsburgh Aviary. He said, I wanted to show you this bird. I help kids out in the schoolrooms. And he said, I can get you in this art show. I like your paintings. You want to paint birds? I said, why do I want to paint birds? But I thought, you know what? He encouraged me. So the summer of 88, I painted a bunch of birds. He got me in my first art show, November of 88. And who was set up near me? My future wife, I didn't know that, Maria, yeah. And her sister and her brother-in-law.
Nice. Well, the paintings that you had at the bar and so forth, were you selling them at the bar, or just showing them?
Showing them, and some people would ask for them, but I didn't want to sell them because I wasn't sure where I was going to go with it.
Okay.
Then I wasn't in the reproduction at point. I was just a hobby for me, so I wasn't sure what to do.
Everything there were originals.
But they encourage it, and they had to be small because we had a busy bar, yards and fish bowls. So I did, that was that, and then the bird paint, 1988, then my life changed dramatically for the better with meeting Maria.
Mm-hmm. And then at that point, you decided to, how much longer did it take before you started doing artwork full-time and not being a bartender?
That was 88. I wrote a note to Elsie Hillman. She's gone now. What a wonderful friend, and what she did for Pittsburgh and her husband. And I had note cards. Meeting Maria, so I decided to make little note cards out of one of my Pittsburgh at nights. She bought 500 cards. Okay, this is a sign. People like it, mine. And then we struck a relationship up.
Okay.
Which is what, okay, this is what I need to do. So I'm just painting. I did a painting of Roberto Clemente. I had to do that because of one of my heroes.
Right, it's a passion.
And then also I did a painting about a dancer. It's called A Dancer. I just love dance, and I love people doing that, and I just did that. Then Marie and I, we said, let's go. This is before I started my business. Let's find a place and let's reproduce, make prints, because this is all new to us. And we did, and they started selling. So not a whole lot, but it gave me encouragement. And then let's go up to 2000. One of the marketing people I met through a connection saw my paintings at Mario's, and they said, hey, we have Heinz Field opening up. Would you be interested in maybe we could do a commission for you for Heinz Field? So that was whoa. So I end up having a meeting with Mr. Rooney, the ambassador who's gone now. What a wonderful man he was and what he did for us and everybody else. And they gave me the final architectural drawings of Heinz Field. And Mr. Rooney said, make it come alive, Johno. So immediately, the original painting is 4 feet by 5. It's been hanging at Heinz Field since 2001. It's 19 years now. It's right there in the steward lobby. So I could not be more honored and proud as a Pittsburgher, a fan and artist. So that's when I started my business in 2000.
Right.
And I was still tending bar a little bit because we were working out things. Mm-hmm. And but these two signs there. And then a couple years later, Ed Bouchette, our well-known sports writer here in town, also he votes for the Hall of Fame in football. He said, Johno, maybe send some of your, he loved my work, send some of pictures of your prints to the Hall of Fame. And I did, and they loved them. So five of my prints are in the Pro Football Hall of Fame. That was 2004. So just those little steps, mm-hmm. those baby steps.
Well, talk to me about your style, your skill, because you do some stuff that is different than any paintings that I've ever seen. So talk a little bit about your skill as an artist. Where did you develop it?
Well, the Rust-Oleum, that was a good one to train on, but I was cleaning my brush out with gasoline.
Yeah.
So I wanted to be around. The colitis didn't kill me, but the gasoline might have. So we're good. So that was kind of goopy paint. So I decided to get away from that, get into enamels that are you can wash your hands with soap and water. So that's health-wise, and also it was better. And there was more color selection. Then I decided one day I like sand. I just like sand. I like dirt. And I'm a blue-collar kind of guy and gritty guy. I started putting sand in the paint because in the art world, to me, the rules are no rules. So these are not traditional artist paints. I get them from the hardware store, but I love it.
Mm-hmm.
And it holds sand really well, and it just kind of moves with it. And it's just one of those things. I think I invented it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see it anywhere else.
So.
And I get it from the river, the Monongahela.
Mm-hmm.
And it just gives it an earthy, gritty thing. And I like, it's, I guess, kind of like making bread with your hands. You got to work with it. And a lot of times I paint flat, and it just gives it a different look in the colors and the shine. It's worked, and I have not looked back on that.
So you just take regular latex enamels that you get at the hardware store.
Yes, sir.
And a handful of sand, you're mixing them together, and that's what you're painting with.
Right, that's my medium.
Okay.
How about
your brushes? Do you have thousands of different brushes like Maria does?
No, or? Not like my wife.
Okay.
I'm a pretty simple guy. I love fan brushes and stripers and a couple other ones. I maybe have four or five I use, and that's what I like to use.
And you use them until they fall apart.
I fill them apart, and then I repurpose them.
Right. And then you go from there.
Now, when I do special commissions.
When did you do your first... How old were you when you did your first painting? You said you were in the garage with Rust-Oleum. And
right.
You were.
I can tell you when it was. It was 1983.
Okay.
That was the same later that year after my big surgery.
Okay.
My dad says, here, I'm Slovak. My dad was Slovak. My mom was German, so I'm half Slovak. He says, up in the living room, here, I trust you. Paint the Slovak coat of arms and paint the German coat of arms on the wall.
Mm-hmm.
And I did. And the one is the line with the Slovak, the two tails, and the eagle, kind of a modern look is with the German. And it looked great. Then there was the big hallway up on the second floor. There's this huge tiger I painted at scaffolding. And I was starting as a muralist, little be known. And Maria, you know, how Maria did that. And those were started right there. Then I just got canvases. I went to a local art store and just charted up, you know, figured this out. There was nobody guiding me at all. I had nobody. I would just have the interest and the thirst to learn.
The interest and the thirst. Well, the canvases that you use, I see, are a lot bigger than the normal canvases that I see most artists and everything use on them. Is there a reason you pick the sizes you do? You just like to think big, and
you got
a big head, so you got big pictures?
I don't have a big head.
Okay.
I know that. I like strength. And
okay.
I have a semi-carpenter background. I like overbuilding things.
Okay.
And back then they were just a half inch or 1 inch and they were wobbly. So they come out with the bigger canvas gallery wrap. They're 1 or 2 inches. And it has more of a, if you're going to do something, it's going to last a while. You want to start with the right material. And I just love working. And I always paint my edges. That way people don't have to frame them.
And your larger prints, I mean, do you spend... days, weeks, months on different prints? Do you start paintings? Do you start 6-7 different ones at a time?
Sometimes there's two or three. When the bigger ones, sometimes it's 6 weeks to 2 months that are involved. Other ones can come at you in a couple days or a week. It really depends what's going on at that time or how it speaks to me.
So it speaks to you. You have an idea, you wake up one night and or one morning and you say, I got an idea, I want to do something.
Right.
And that's where you see the colors. Right. But a lot of your stuff, is it mostly Pittsburgh, or do you like the animals and the trees? And the artwork of yours that I've seen has pretty much been all over the board. There's no one theme to your
artwork. Thank you. I like that diversity.
Yes, very diverse.
Thank you. I would say half my work is Pittsburgh, which I am a Pittsburgher, and I love our city and I love the people better. Then the other half is I love nature and I love different things. There's probably a dark side that people go, I don't need to go to the dark side because there's so much happiness and color in life, and I have all the colors, and I like to do that. And you go from there.
Yeah. Showing your work, when did you have your first... big viewing?
It was actually, it was Mario's Blues. It was 1990. It was my world premiere on the second floor Blues. When I worked there, Bob Pesolano let me have that place for a few days, and that gave me the confidence.
How many
pieces
of art did you have?
There maybe was 20 back then.
Okay.
And it was well
received.
And at that
point, were you selling it?
Yes, I was.
Okay.
Yeah, and people were interested, absolutely. And that's when I had prints at the time. So I learned, you know, I can keep an original and sell the prints of that. The originals, I kind of wanted to hold on to them because I thought that might be
Do you still have a lot of your originals?
I have a few, but a lot of them now are in different places in private art collections, a few museums. So it depends. Now, if I know where they're going to go and, you know, it works out good, why not?
Okay.
Let somebody else enjoy them. I don't hoard them.
Okay.
But the originals are my babies.
Okay. So you take your original and you have a photographer?
Yeah, that's how it starts. A very good photographer, and then they put on a disc and you can reproduce it on a stamp or a side of a building with the technology they have now.
Now, how much commissioned work do you do compared to you just have an idea type of work?
Commissions have been good over the years. Maybe half of them are commissions. And then when you're self-employed, the other half, I'm always painting and trying to figure out, well, okay, I like to pay my bills and eats.
Mm-hmm.
So, and also what people might want, or maybe current events. I like to stay on top of things the best I can.
Now, you've had, you mentioned Hillman, the Rooneys. You've actually had some artwork shown in Hollywood, haven't you?
Yes, how about that? Over the years, my business has developed where people buy my prints or work online, and I ship it across America and sometimes across the world. And then ended up in Hollywood back in 2005. And this gentleman called me up and said, hey, Johno, I have two of your Steeler prints in my office. And my name's Tim. And I have a show called Will and Grace. I never heard of it. So I said, okay, that's cool. He says, but I love your work and you're a Pittsburgher. I like to put something on, but it's not conducive to sports or Pittsburgh. What do you have to show me? And I had a Hollyhocks and a dancer. And the Hollyhocks were an inspiration from my dad's garden in Dormont back in the day. And I had that and they loved it. So I ended up on the final episode, 2006 of May, my Hollywood print. So it had to be a connection where somebody liked my work in a position of power and they remembered me.
What are some of the other unusual showings that you've had for your artwork?
Well, I've been with KDK since 2005, Pittsburgh Today Live and other things. I did all the set work there from 2010 to 2015. This guy right here was on the set.
He's on the set.
I did the seasonal work, so that was awesome. KDK, Pittsburgh, I couldn't be more proud of that time I was there. Here's another one. Also, Will and Grace, last year in March, the show came back the year before, and they contacted me. Two of my hearts ended up there, so they didn't forget me either.
Right.
And what they're telling me now with Hollywood, it's crazy dealing with Hollywood. We're dealing with them up here. Some of my other work will be on in the future, which is wonderful. So, but through all this, L.C. Hillman, I had a presidential commission.
Oh, okay.
L.C. Hillman and George H.W. Bush Sr. were friends, lifelong friends, President Bush 41. So after he got out of office, L.C. said, my friend Johno, he gets sand from the river and he does these paintings. Why don't you check it out, George? And I didn't know all this. And L.C. had the commission said yes before I even knew about it. How about that? God bless her.
Nice.
So this is a requested portrait by a former president. It's non-political. This is how they want to be remembered. It's in his presidential library at Texas A&M. It hangs still down there since 07. I couldn't be more proud of that as an American and as a Pittsburgher. And also, too, President Bush and I became pen pals. I have 9 letters from him over a series of years that we exchanged letters. We became pen pals. A little bit was about my artwork. Other things were about him. We were talking about things. So I want to publish them someday, do something with that. But I'm saying that come out of a thing. So that's a little unusual or a little different.
Okay. I understand you're on boxes of Sarah's Candy, so you have a Sarah's Candy connection also, don't you?
Oh, yeah. How about that? Let's talk about a sweet deal.
Sweet as in chocolate sweet?
Sweet as all the way around.
Okay.
It started 7 years ago in 2012. I met Bill Saris, and he was looking to do something different after his dad passed. Frank, who I did meet, he says he thought a little bit outside the chocolate box, and he was thinking about photographs, and then he came. I love to donate. Also, too, my wife and I, we love to help people out with art. That's how we do that a lot. A piece of art, if it can help somebody out, raise funds, we do that. So Bill would see some of my work at charity events he would attend. Mm-hmm. So he got a hold of me. And Pittsburgh Daylight, we signed a business agreement. It's a wonderful agreement. It's been 7 years now. So I have Pittsburgh Daylight, black and gold. We had the American flag. I have a Santa Claus now, and then we have another one coming out. I'm not able to disclose, even though I'd like to give you the dibbit.
Yep, understood.
Until something's done.
So it's the boxes of candy itself shipped all over the world.
Right.
They have your different prints and everything on it, so which is amazing.
It's right. And I buy these for myself because, first of all, it's the best.
Because you like the candy.
Chocolate, yeah. Same thing. It's a, first of all, it's an assortment.
It's a chocolate.
I buy it for myself. You know, I first got this gig 7 years ago. I kept eating my own boxes, and I put on 20 pounds real quick. I said, I better stop that.
Quit eating
the chocolates. Well, I do eat. I just pace myself.
Okay.
But these are make great gifts, and we have other ones. So I'm very proud. This is a Pittsburgh company. I'm 7 years in going with them.
Okay.
Plus, my wife, Maria, has done all the murals down there. How unique is that?
And you've been involved with all three of the big sports teams in Pittsburgh, correct?
Football? The Pittsburgh Steelers, the Pirates, not the Pirates per
just
se,
Roberto.
The Roberto Kemeny Museum, which is wonderful. I have three originals down there.
Right. Now, how about the Penguins?
The Penguins. I love the Penguins, too. This past February 16th, 2019, my painting logo of the Penguins logo ended up on a puzzle.
A puzzle.
Okay. My life's been a puzzle, but I'm becoming a puzzle guy right
now.
They have normal
giveaways. So we're finally putting the pieces together.
I don't know about that. Well, that's ongoing. And there's pieces missing, too. And they're all over the chart. But they usually have a bobblehead, a fan night. So anyhow, I was right at the beginning, the first puzzle presented by PPG Paints.
Mm-hmm.
They printed over 19,000 of these. And every ticket holder that game got a Johno puzzle. And I couldn't be more, as a fan of Pittsburgher and all that, it was just so cool. And
Well, tell us about your studio a little bit.
Okay.
When did you move into this facility?
Back in 2000, Maria's mom owned this building.
And
God bless her, she's my second mom.
Okay.
So she needed a little help. We decided, you know what, we already had our own home. Marie and I talk. I was ready to buy a place. Let's see if we get a mortgage on it.
Okay.
And it worked out great.
So what was it prior to you?
First it started out as a gas station in the 30s. And then through there, it was a used car lot. Then Maria's parents bought it in the 80s and it became, first of all, it was Sugar and Spice, an ice cream store and burgers and all that. Then it was her dad's contracting business.
Right.
And then Maria's ideas formed out of here. So
okay.
It was many things. And then after that went away, it was Ann, my mother-in-law, rented it out. And then we ended up buying it off her, and which helped her out, but helped us out even more.
Okay.
And
so you do your actual painting work and everything
most of
here.
It's here, yes, sir.
And also this is a showroom for you.
Right,
and
right.
Someone could come now. Are you have specific hours for the public?
Yes, on every Thursday, I'm always open noon to 6. We've done that for 19 years now. It's worked out perfectly. People pick up stuff and they know. But otherwise, if they contact me either by email or phone call or text or other way, I meet
them. Set up by appointment.
It's by chance or appointment only. As far as I know, I never missed anybody that wanted to talk about art.
So how many, as of today, how many pieces of artwork do you have started in this building right now, do you think?
It's stored in the building.
Started. How many are you working on right now?
There's one, and I'm going to be starting a big future one.
Okay.
So,
but this is where you do all your work
in this area, laid out. Yeah.
Okay. I see quite a few different cans of paint back there, too.
Love paint.
Yeah, he loves paint.
Quartz.
Quartz. Everything's in quartz.
They're easier to handle. I mean, gallons, too, but I like the quartz.
Okay. Yeah. Understood. And then you mix colors and everything for it?
Mix colors, and then the sand goes in
and
there.
And how much sand do you usually collect on any given scavenger hunt?
Maybe a 5 gallon bucket.
About a 5 gallon bucket.
Yeah, let it dry it out and screen it because you never know what's in it.
Right.
And then it gets the sun, get it, and I use it down the road.
Nice.
And then when I do special commissions, I'll give you an example, National Aviary. I was commissioned a few years ago, which is another honor for me. I went into the tropical rainforest and I took out bark, grit, dirt, and some other things. I don't know what they were. So I sterilized them and I ground them up.
Sterilized them,
I love to cook, but I don't like to cook that way.
Yeah.
And so that's in the painting. And it to me, it tells a story, an organic story of that. And the aviary went nuts over it. And the painting is a very focal point on her and the aviary,
yes,
what they do
is
for the birds. And I couldn't be more honored there.
So how about Falling Water? I can't forget about Falling Water. I've seen your artwork from Falling Water also.
That came out of...
I think you're the only artist that has ever been allowed to sell your images of Falling Water up there on the property, aren't you?
I'm not sure, but I think I'm one of the few. A couple years ago, I had a show at Nemacolin, Woodlands, right down the road, and I was able to do an original for the show, and I contacted the Conservancy, and they came down. They love my image, and we signed an exclusive deal. So since then, there's only two places you can get them, at Falling Water and my studio. Right. And people from around the world come there. And there's a great story with the Kaufmans, Frank Lloyd Wright, and it's basically in our backyard here in Pittsburgh.
We're very fortunate for it. So going forward, what's on what's out there on the horizon for Johno Prasek?
You never know what's coming around that corner. But if you have to think about, I come from a steel family, steel making family, roots of it. My grandfather was named Johno. Johno is a version of Johno.
Okay.
If you had, to me, if you had to pick one of the iconic mills of Pittsburgh, it would be the old Carnegie Steel Homestead Mill.
Right.
So I been thinking about this for about a year. It's going to be 28 feet long, 3 feet high on 7 canvases.
That'll fill this building.
It'll probably start the end and maybe go out the door. And I just want to do it, and it's from the 20s. I'm dealing with the Rivers of Steel Foundation. We've been talking.
Great foundation.
My grandfather, I never met him. He worked in the mill as a boilermaker, and one day in the early 50s, he collapsed, and he died a week later in his home in Munhall. A sad story, but I just feel his presence. So. And then my dad worked there after World War II when he was going to Duquesne University. So there's a little personal connection, but all the thousands of people work there. And nobody has painted on this scale in the way I paint. So I'm ready to rip into it.
Okay. So it'll be how many canvases?
7 canvases. They'll be 3 foot by 4, and they'll be all together like a train. And then when it's displayed, it'll be, you'll probably pull them a foot apart.
Stay tuned. We're going to have to see this one.
I'm documenting Pittsburgh's past.
How about this? These images... on this glass that we, what is this?
This is wonderful. This is art printed on glass. Art, like this. Okay, art printed on glass. It's a company I've partnered with, and my wife and JP DeRoll. It's called Imagio. They're out of Detroit. How about this, folks? Instead of having tile or other things in your house, you can have glass custom made with any artwork on the back. Three of us local artists signed exclusive with them, and this is something we feel is going to take off in this market and outside of this market. This could be a global thing, and you could use this as art, function, bath showers, all over.
Yeah.
So this is a sample piece. Thank you.
And this will be any of your artwork?
Any of my artwork?
Any of your artwork you can reproduce on this glass.
Yeah, and bits and pieces of it. Whatever the imagination is. So.
Yeah, we're pretty excited about that, Johno.
Exactly. Thank you very much. It's new.
Yep. So what else? Anything else to share with us? Or we're going to just take a look around here.
You're welcome to take a look around. I pretty much touched on it. Also, a real special one. I did one for the United States, painting for the United States Naval Academy.
I'm not aware of that.
There was the Campbell brothers from Homestead.
Right.
They were well off. The Bill Campbell. He donated over $10 million to the area over 10 years. Well, his younger brother was a tremendous athlete and pilot at the Naval Academy, and he was on the Roger Staubach quarterback team. And his go-to receiver was a guy from Pittsburgh, Jim Campbell. So Jim passed away years ago. So the Steel Valley History Club came to me, so I did a painting of Jim's Homestead years and his Naval years that hangs over at Steel Valley. During the dedication, it was awesome. I got goosebumps. We had retired admirals, Navy people coming. I just felt great to be an American. They're coming up here to see this and pay homage. Yeah, my little painting, my big painting. So right there, they said, you want to do a painting for the United States Naval Academy, Johno? I says, where do I sign?
Yeah.
So in 2008, I did a painting of Jim Campbell's Navy years that hangs at the Academy. So what they did, they got me sand from the golf course at the Naval Academy because Jim loved to play golf. And also, Jim, his home was in Phoenix. So I got Phoenix sand there with Monongahela sand. So that's an interesting tidbit.
So out of all your artwork, do you have a favorite?
My last one.
Your last one?
Yeah. But if I have to pick one, if you're asking me to pick one, okay, say we're all mortal here in this life. And I think as me, it would be one painting. I've had discussions with artists and photographers and just people in general. The painting I would pick right now would be the Pittsburgh Daylight.
And that's one you have on this piece?
Yeah, that would be this one. It would be my obituary, however they write that. But if I, the Will and Grace, the Presidential, all these other ones. But I'm a Pittsburgher, and this is the one I would pick, and that's what I want to do.
Excellent. Well, we appreciate your time.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for taking the time to talk to us, and looking forward to showing
us around. And Dave,
thank
you. Bethel Park TV, always welcome. Mm-hmm.